We'll have the roll call by the clerk.
Chairman Cogswell?
Here.
Counselor Amaro?
Here.
Counselor Creelman?
Here.
Counselor Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
Counselor Pearson?
Here.
And Counselor Reed?
Here.
The next item on the agenda is something that we're doing for the first time, and we'll later consider whether or not we'll be doing it regularly. Michael? You'll all stand for Pledge of Allegiance to the flag and join us, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The minutes of the meeting number 8, 1990-91, which was held on Wednesday, November 14th, 1990. Are there any corrections or additions? Mr. McGovern?
Yes, when I was looking through these this morning in response to a question that Chairman Cogswell had, I noticed there was and what I thought to be an error on the item relating to the Animal Refuge League, which is under item number 95 on page 4. It was my understanding at the end of the meeting, when that point was decided, that it was the decision of the council to authorize a 6-month agreement with the Animal Refuge League for 50 cents per capita divided by 2, since it was for half a year, and that only if that was not agreeable to the Animal Refuge League would that come back to the council.
Any comments? Is that how you believe we voted?
I think so.
All right.
That was my understanding. I seconded the motion.
Then may I have approval of minutes?
So moved with that correction.
Second.
All in favor? Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. This is an opportunity for the citizens to come forward and make statements on any particular item or concerns. Is there anyone who'd like to come forward? There being none, we'll move on to the next item, which is reports from correspondents. Councilor Reed?
Yes, Madam Chairman. I had the opportunity on November 26 to represent the town of Cape Elizabeth at Southern Maine Technical College with the delegation from Archangel, the Russian municipal officers, the arts people that came over in South Portland. And I met, and at that meeting I was given the key to the city of Archangel, which we have on display at the town hall. Thank you.
Any other reports and correspondence? Councilor Pearson.
Madam Chairman, a couple things. Last week I attended the Maine Municipal Association's Legislative Policy Committee meeting up in Augusta, and must say that the association's agenda for the legislature is very ambitious this year, and I will try to get that in some kind of order that you can all receive a copy of that. Right now it's still in mumble jumble. I haven't had time to get that all straightened out. And one of the people attending the meeting said that he overheard one of the legislators say on opening day that he hopes municipal officials were aware of how bad things are. And that person chased down that person and said, "I think we know more than you know." And the other thing, I was approached by a resident of town that is concerned about hunting that's been going on at Trundy Point, which I talked with Michael, and I believe that's a federal property, and therefore hunting is legal. But Michael's going to check into that.
It's not a federal property, Trundy Point, but it is. The town does not regulate the discharge of firearms over open waters, is my understanding. But I'd be happy to check into it.
Councilor Creelman.
He says, a member of the county, Cumberland County Budget Advisory Committee, I attended this afternoon's second and final budget hearing to the public in the probate court room. As I had indicated prior to this evening, the projected increase percent tax change for the county budget for fiscal year 1991 was a 5.7 increase. Unfortunately, what has happened over the last year is that the Cumberland County Civic Center has run a deficit, and as a consequence of both the deficit as well as bonds, notes, and other obligations, there's an extra $218,051 in their budget. This had not been placed in the budget yet. This is going to amount to an approximate 2% increase in the overall Cumberland County budget. There is a thought that there may be in the ballpark of about a $100,000 surplus overall, which may bring that additional 2% down again. But the bottom line from Commissioner Mazziotti was that the final budget will be somewhere between 5.7 and 7.7% increase for this coming fiscal year. The three commissioners will vote on this budget this coming Friday, Friday the 14th of December, for finalization. If anyone should have any concerns about the final budget, they need to get their concerns to one of the three county commissioners, obviously before Friday, at which time the budget will be officially voted to be law. I should note that there were very few people at the budget hearing today, and I think we can take some pride in our own town manager was one of the two town managers representing 25 municipalities in Cumberland County, both our town manager McGovern and Don Gerrish, I believe he's from Brunswick, were the two town managers there. So I think our town manager indicated to all present what a lean year we have before us, and that any increase in expenditures at the county level was really unfortunate. However, the bottom line looks like it will be somewhere between 5.7 and 7.7%, and we will have a final figure on that this coming Friday.
Thank you. Is there anyone else? Councilor.
Madam Chairman, thank you. I want to report on my attendance at the Council of Governments Executive Committee meeting a couple of weeks ago. One presentation was by Councilor David McCain from Wyndham, who distributed and discussed information about the using the expenditure control budget method of setting a budget, and I will be getting that material to all of the town council members and to our school board members. I think the written material provided was informative. They were trying to get a feel for interest in having a consultant come and discuss this kind of budgeting. My feeling is that the written information is quite satisfactory. I'm not going to recommend that we look any further into having the consultant be sponsored by COG. Other COG communities may feel differently, of course. We also had the auditor's draft report for COG presented. It's staying in draft form for the time being. While things are looking better for this year than they had in the past, there are still past debts that were incurred by COG, and the current problem is how to satisfactorily deal with those debts. And I'll keep you informed as that progresses. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, I just want to bring to the attention of members of the town council that the Portland Headlight Study Group is having a special tour tomorrow morning of the headlight tower.
At 1 o'clock.
Oh, it's 1 o'clock now? At 1 o'clock at the headlight, if you're interested. Also, we received a letter from our newly elected state representative, Steve Simons, offering to present to the state legislature any items of concern that we have as a municipality. And we as a whole received a letter from Mr. Michael Maroon in reference to various financial procedures and some comments on those. We will now move on to the public hearing for the proposed bicycle ordinance. And Councillor McLaughlin of the Ordinance Committee will give us a little bit of background on that.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I'm going to read just a tad from this rewrite of the bicycle ordinance. What we're trying to do is insert some common sense into the ordinance language and make it specific to Cape Elizabeth. The stated purpose of the bicycle ordinance is, the purpose of this bicycle ordinance is to ensure the safety and welfare of bicyclists and the public at large relative to the ownership and operation of bicycles. Goes on to say that licensing a bike in Cape Elizabeth is not going to be mandatory, but it is going to be a service provided by our police department that would assist owners in recovering a bicycle if it were stolen. Goes on to say that a bicycle being operated in this town shall have reflectors and a brake. If it's going to be operated at night, it should have a light. And encourages all bicycle operators to ride safely and follow the vehicular regulations of the road.
Thank you. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to come forth and make a statement on this new ordinance? There being none, we'll close the public hearing and move on to item 106, to consider the adoption of a new bicycle ordinance and take any necessary action. Councilors?
Madam Chairman, I would move that we adopt the revised bicycle ordinance, Chapter 14 of our Code of Ordinances.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor of adopting the new ordinance? 7-0. Our next public hearing, the zoning and subdivision ordinance amendments regarding application completeness and other minor revisions. Once again, Chairman McLaughlin will give us the information.
Thank you. These are pretty minor revisions, but I want to make sure that everybody understands what they entail. It's basically revisions to the ordinances relating to preliminary and final major subdivisions, to minor subdivisions, and to the site plan section of the zoning ordinance. It says in all of those sections that the application shall be submitted to the town planner, and within 30 days of receiving a final application, the planner shall consult with the planning board chairperson or vice chairperson, making a preliminary determination about the completeness of the application. If it's determined that the application is not complete, then a written determination to that effect will be sent out to the applicant and with a list of what else is needed to make the application complete. If there is no response from the applicant within 4 months, the application will be deemed withdrawn. When the application is determined to be complete, it will be scheduled for the next available planning board meeting. It needs to be clearly understood that no action, and this is stated in the ordinance, that no action taken by the town planner shall result in an application being deemed pending under the state law purposes. The town planner does not do the substantive review. The planning board still retains that. That is basically the gist of the revisions. It's giving the planning board is having the town planner do more of the paperwork, basically, that the planning board used to have to wade through. I personally consider that a very appropriate use of our full-time town planner. And having the completeness issues addressed prior to going to the planning board. A hope is that this will make the procedure clear, maybe a little easier, and let people get through our procedure a bit faster than they have in the past, potentially.
Thank you. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to come forward and make a comment on this new subdivision change? There being none, we'll close the public hearing and go on to consider item number 107, to consider proposed amendments to the zoning and subdivision ordinances regarding application completeness and other minus revisions and take any necessary action. Councilor Jordan.
I'll move that we adopt the proposed amendments to the subdivision and zoning ordinance regarding application completeness plus other minor revisions.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. The next public hearing is to begin consideration of the fiscal year 1992 budget process and projections. This is just, as we all know, with the state of our economy, an earlier beginning in our process. This is an invitation for the public to express their concerns, and we'll probably allow about 20 minutes for expressing these concerns. And I ask that we try to be concise and not overly repetitive. I will turn this over to Chairman of the Finance Committee, Wayne Krillman.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. For those of you who were here or listening to our council meeting last month, as Chairman of the Finance Committee for fiscal year 1992's budget, I had recommended that this evening we have an opportunity to get and receive input from the public with respect to feelings, thoughts, opinions with respect to the financial circumstances of the 1992 budget. In the spirit of the one-town concept and in the spirit of parity with municipal and school components of the budget, I had hoped to have a bit of a public hearing this evening to solicit this input. As you know, the school board has asked the town council at a joint workshop a few months ago to give them direction with respect to the bottom line. And my hope had been, in a bit of an unusual way, to give them a guide to that bottom line prior to their giving us a final dollar figure, which is not the process we typically use. However, my thought was that in doing it this way, we might minimize some of the problems that we ran into last year with giving figures and creating cuts and issues coming back and forth between the town council and the school board. As a reminder for the public, we are currently in fiscal year 1991. Fiscal year 1991 was a 9.9% overall tax increase from fiscal year 1990. The components of a tax increase are fourfold. They include municipal, school, community services, and county. Last year, the municipal increase was 2.1%. The school was 11.3%, community services was 0%, and the county was a whopping 36.4%. Thankfully, this year it won't be above 7.7. The municipal side required a $3.36 per $1,000 of assessed valuation, which caused a total spending increase of $226,000. Currently, this year, I've already indicated that things look lean. Currently, excise taxes, projecting for fiscal year 92, are down about 10%. The investment income is down approximately 26%. Permits are down about 70%. State revenue sharing is down approximately 5%. We have no use of a surplus at this particular time. One bright spot is that there are some other revenues which give us about a 4% increase in the ballpark of $11,000. So what I thought would be helpful this evening was to solicit input, but really to try to answer two questions if we can. One is, should we use this approach this year, unlike the approach we have used in other years? And if so, should we look to some ballpark figure? Not that we're going to etch that figure in stone, but at least have a rough ballpark figure as a projected maximum amount the overall tax rate would go up for fiscal year 1992. That was my hope for this particular hearing and input. And I will yield to the town manager, because I think Mr. McGovern has some even more specific numbers for us to reflect about in the context of soliciting input.
I really don't like holding the microphone, but I think it's probably necessary. I'd like to thank Chairman Krailman of the Finance Committee for his opportunity, as well as the Council's opportunity, to provide a more in-depth outlook at how we see the fiscal year 1992 budget. The numbers that you'll see here on the flip charts primarily come from a document that's prepared each year by the department heads and myself, which we entitle a budget impact schedule. And this is a document that each of the department heads has had quite a bit of opportunity to provide input on, and it really truly shows probably what we're looking at for the fiscal year beginning next July. As Councilor Krailman mentioned, one of the particular areas of concern in this year's budget is the whole area of non-property tax revenues. These are all the revenues that we receive on the municipal side, with the exception of the property tax. This first column that you see here is fiscal year 1991. The second column is fiscal year 1992. And the third column indicates the dollar changes. Excise taxes, Councilor Krailman mentioned, down 10%. That's a difference of $80,000. Why is that? It's because if you check with your neighbors, you look at yourselves, a lot of people aren't buying new cars to the degree that they were. You pick up the newspaper and you see General Motors and all the different auto companies are reporting greatly reduced sales. Excise tax goes up or down depending on whether or not folks are purchasing new vehicles. Investment income is projected to be down next year by $67,500. The reason for that is the fact that interest rates are lower than they had been, as well as the fact that the auditors recently recommended that we needed to collateralize all of our funds in financial institutions because of some of the concerns that everyone has with financial institutions. There is an expense to collateralization, and it does show up here. That's a loss of estimated of $67,500. We only need to look around Cape Elizabeth to see that construction is way down. This year, the projected income in the budget was a little over $69,000. Next year, it's projected to be $20,000. We heard the governor, I think a week ago Friday, indicate that state revenues are down. When this was first put together several weeks ago, at that point, I was estimating a 5% decline. Who knows? I think, you know, as we listen to the governor more, I have more reason to believe that it might even be a little bit more than 5%. Councilor Krailman mentioned use of surplus. Each year we look to see how much funds we have in our surplus account to see how much we can use to help reduce the budget. This year it's $190,600. Our overall surplus, undesignated surplus, is around $650,000. That may sound like a lot of money, but when you look at the general fund of the community over the course of a year, now spends a little over $13 million, including the school department. This amount, a little over $600,000, is actually only enough to keep the town going for about 3 weeks. So I think when you look at it in that context, I don't think it's that much money to have in the bank, you know, compared to what any one individual homeowner would want to have. Other revenues are up a little. Overall, non-property tax revenues are projected to be almost $400,000 less this year than they are during the current year. That's a difference of 19.4%. Less than we have now. In the budget impact schedule, we also looked at expenditures. You see here the line repeated again on non-property tax revenue, the decrease. Expenditures, this is if all was according to normal, we purchased those things that we had anticipated to purchase. We look at the county tax that was just mentioned. We look at health insurance rates, which for the town are up 9.9%. We look at some wage increases, and we look at equipment purchases. All of the projections the department heads put forward showed that next year we would be spending $442,000 more than we spent this year, an increase of 10%. You add up together the $400,000 loss and the over $400,000 increase, it comes out from taxation. If nothing happened, if we went according to, this is what we ought to do, which I don't think many would say we ought to do, it shows that we would collect from taxation, or have to collect from taxation, an additional $837,000. That is 37% more than we're collecting in fiscal year 1991. Because we are not having a whole lot of property construction, we don't have a whole lot of new valuation, in fact, we may even have a little less, that amount would directly translate into what a tax rate increase would be. It's one of the questions the Finance Committee and the Council is requesting is to know, to get a feel from the public on if we have a tax increase, what it should be. If we did not have any tax increase, we would need to reduce from, this is just the municipal and county budgets only, this does not include schools, we would need to reduce $828,000. If we had a 5% tax increase, we would need to reduce $728,000. If you notice, every 5% is about $100,000, every percent is about $20,000. A 7% tax increase would be about $688,000, and a 10% tax increase would still need to reduce $628,000 from what we hope to do, but not necessarily from the actual budget. If you look at the actual budget, which is a little bit different than what we had hoped to do, the current budget for municipal and county services is $4.3 million. With no tax increase at all, because of the loss in revenues, we would need to reduce that by $400,000 down to $3.9 million. If we had a 5% tax increase, we would still have to reduce spending down to $4 million, a 10% tax increase down to $4.1 million. I didn't put the number on here, but I think a little bit of quick math shows that in order to even reach the same level of funding that we had last year, we'd have to have a 20% tax increase. And we know there are areas in the budget where we're going to have increases that are automatically going to be trying to push up that spending money, such as the health insurance, the county tax, workers' compensation, as well as a number of other areas. Where is this going to come from if we need to have reductions? And I would presume, obviously we're not going to have a 37% tax increase. Looking at the current budget, some of this is a little bit debatable in terms of expenses, but it shows that fixed costs, according to what I would consider fixed costs within the budget, consist of 25% of the budget. Those are such things as the county tax, debt service, hydrant rental, which is a bill the Portland Water District sends us every month, regional waste systems disposal fees, which are determined from the waste we put over the year before, as well as insurance. Some can say insurance, you might save a nickel here, a nickel there, that's true. But essentially, that's 25% of the budget, or a little over a million. Labor costs are almost exactly 50% of the budget. That includes direct wages, as well as workers' comp, health insurance, and a number of other smaller areas, but essentially wages and benefits. Other costs, the entire rest of the budget is about 25% of the budget. That includes all utilities, maintenance, fuel, salt, books, streetlights, human services, general assistance, legal fees, postage, printing, travel, training, paving, equipment, and miscellaneous other things such as the contribution of the general fund into the sewer fund. So I think when you look at these numbers and you look at the 25% of fixed cost, and you look at some of these areas, general assistance you have to pay no matter what. It's a mandate under state law. And some of these other areas, obviously you need to have utilities to heat the buildings, you need to have gas to keep the police cruisers going. It shows that, there's a real difficult problem ahead with trying to reduce the budget to a level that is probably acceptable. So I think, you know, what all these numbers show is we've got an awful lot of work in front of us. What I've asked to do, working with the department heads, is to begin to prepare a list of possible areas that can be looked at. Looking back at these numbers from what they had hoped, my sense is, you know, we're probably in, you know, what the council eventually comes up in this range somewhere here, and I, you know, it's up to the council and citizens. But say, for instance, it's $700,000 that we need to find. When you look at $700,000 and put it back onto this sheet here, you know, out of a total budget of $4.3 million, you can see how difficult it begins to be to find the amount of money that we're looking for reductions. And I think I say that in letting everyone know that nothing is going to be pleasant. There are extremely difficult decisions. What I'm asking the department heads to do is to come up with a list of about $1 million so that then from that million we can pick those that are the most objectionable, the least objectionable, depending the way you look at it, and eventually work ourselves into the level that the council tells us that we want to have reduced, assuming that there is a reduction. But in order to reach that amount, we've got to develop a pretty good list so that we have things to pick and choose from. There, I've already had some discussions with department heads as to what might be on the list. All of it at this point is very, very preliminary discussion. And, you know, my sense is, you know, I know there's a lot of people here on one particular issue, and, you know, that is one of probably 500 issues that we're going to be facing before this budget process is done. And, you know, I would hope that, you know, before the council, myself, or anyone jumps to a whole lot of conclusions, that one looks at the entire picture of what it is that we have before us, because it isn't going to be too pleasant. One slight analogy I have is, looking at this whole budget process, I was at a session recently in council manager relations, and they discussed what was the manager's job. And one of the managers there said it was his job was like the old circus, where you went and you saw that the person there trying to balance all the pie plates. Some of you may remember they kept adding pie plates and adding pie plates. That's a little bit of the situation the town has been in. We've been lucky to keep adding pie plates and adding pie plates and being able to keep spinning those around by additional revenues, all those sorts of things. I think the issue as we look down the road is, how are we going to be able to keep all the pie plates from falling? And do we want to have fewer pie plates, or do we want to have a whole lot of wobbly pie plates that eventually fall off? And I think as you look at this whole budget process down the road, I would hope that you'd begin to think of those pie plates and think of, you know, what is the type of municipal government that you want. One that you have a number of real strong areas, or numbers where you're willing to take a little bit of risk that maybe you'll have some wobbliness for a little bit of a time, but the pie plate actually won't fall. And that's essentially the outlook for fiscal year 1992. Thank you.
I might just make one last comment before we solicit public opinion. And that is that everything that I have spoken about this evening and the town manager boils down to approximately 29% of our budget. We are not here this evening to discuss the school budget. And as you all know, if things this year go true to form, the school budget will be somewhere in the ballpark of 65.2% of the overall 100%. So right now we're only talking about 29%, the municipal part of the four components to the overall tax increase.
Any public comment? If so, please come forward and give your name and address, the microphone. And if there are any groups that want to have one or two delegated spokespeople.
Hi, my name is Nicholas A. Young, and I live at 80 Brentwood Road in Cape Elizabeth, and I'm a 13-year resident of the town. Mr. McGovern certainly paints a pretty grim picture here, and you know, it's understandable that the downturn in the economy has affected many, many aspects of the economy and as well as the town. The as far as the school budget is concerned, I can tell you that I have no children now in school, and but yet I'm proud of the Cape Elizabeth school system. It's kind of nice to know that you come from a town where the school system is considered the best in the state. But as I said, it's obvious now that we're going to need a tax increase in the state as well as drastic reductions in the budget. And but some of the reductions that I've been hearing on the municipal side of the thing are kind of disturbing to me, probably given that I don't have children in school, so that other things are kind of important to me. I certainly, as I said before, endorse the quality of education here in the town, but you know, I just cannot support maintaining the quality of education that we have in the town while at the expense of diminution of other services in the town. And in the case of the fire department, for example, we have a full-time fire chief now. We've had a full-time fire chief for 4.5 years. Apparently it was determined that there was a need for that 4.5 years ago, and I just can't believe that if it's considered that that position should disappear, that the reasons that placed that position there in the first place have disappeared. The as a matter of fact, I would think that the need for that position is even greater than it was originally. The town certainly has grown since 1986. Certainly, it is anticipated that in the future this town is going to grow, and I assume that others feel the same way, since apparently we now have just recently added a full-time town planner. So it's obvious that the town is expecting to grow and wants to plan for that particular growth. The town of Cape Elizabeth has been blessed, I believe, with volunteer efforts in the fire rescue and other areas of the town, and probably many towns would envy the dedication that Cape Elizabeth has had from volunteers. However, I think by and large volunteerism is diminishing, and I think that this is a result of demands on people's time, two income families, two working spouses, etc., where the time has to be budgeted, and I think volunteerism down the road is going to suffer. So that obviously volunteerism is not the wave of the future. So the desire to save in the town, I believe, must not come at the expense of eliminating the only full-time fire protection individual that we have in this town. It certainly would be a step backwards, and I believe it would be penny-wise and pound-foolish to even consider that. We certainly cannot justify the elimination of a position whose need was identified as long as 12 years ago when John Henchy was manager here, and filled 5 years ago, and while retaining some planner or some new position that was only put on weeks ago. And that's my feeling on this. And I don't believe that we can afford to gold plate any department in this town, not in this day and age. But we certainly cannot have our heads in the sand as far as the future of this town and the public safety issues. Thank you.
Anyone else?
My name is Michael Davis. I live at 23 Angel Terrace. I live in South Poulton, as a matter of fact. I'm the captain of engine company number one, for those of you who don't know me. I'm here tonight to ask you, talk to you a little about the fire department budget. I'm here to ask that we please don't cut this budget. This budget is a budget where you pay a dollar and you get 5 to 7 back. We are probably one of the few, if not the only, department that is not pay driven. When I say that to you, I mean that pay is not the reason that we come to work every day, or the reason we come to work when you have a call. We come to work because we want to do this. And my engine company, more than half of my members, including some of the officers and myself, don't even live in your town. We come here because we have been people who have lived in your town, and we want to just help our fellow people. True volunteerism. It's easy when you look upon my chief, who was a full-time employee, to say, well, no, you can't have this money. But when you're saying that to him, you're also saying that to me and the rest of the people in my department. Makes it very hard from my perspective as the captain to go back to my people and say, I'm sorry, guys, they cut our truck or they cut all our helmets this year. It just makes it very hard on my people's morale. It's very hard to explain to them. They don't understand. The truth of the matter is that none of this equipment will get cheaper. Every year, they tell me that the equipment is increasing by about 8%. To put this equipment off, I understand our budget crunch situation. I'm in the same predicament in my town in South Portland. Everybody is. But I ask that we're a very small department, and that when you look upon our budget, you look upon the people who are serving you, giving their time, and the only thing that they're really asking out of you is, can we have quality equipment to use? That's all we're asking. That's where most of our money goes. The little bit of money that you put into paying us, that I actually would earn as the captain, $650 in a year, that money would barely cover the gas that cost me to go to and from the fires, drills, other meetings that I have to go to. It's very, very, very small amount that goes to the people. The big question is, can these people have quality equipment to use? We have it now. This council has always been good to us in this town. But I ask you, please, if you do anything, let's hold the line on our budget. Thank you.
Other comments?
My name is Dean Stearns. I live at 5 Penwood Circle. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth 14 years now. I guess Michael and the rest have your plates full. You have a full plate, that's for sure, to try to balance this out and take care of all the needs. The primary thing that I would request is that really try to give, and I'm sure you will, but give due consideration to all the various age groups and the constituencies in the town. I've had some children go through the schools and the various activities, and I feel very good about that. Now that I'm in, I guess, the middle age group, probably the older than middle age group now, unfortunately, right? Then you do start thinking of some other things too, and the safety issues are very important. And as I'm sure that you've heard, there has been a rumor around there's going to be some cutback, particularly on the fire department side. I would cite one example that I've been through. as all of us probably belong to various nonprofits, and a nonprofit that I'm involved in has an executive director, and that executive director and a clerical person both went out on maternity. And I want to tell you, those of us who thought we were working pretty hard and pretty good volunteers didn't do very well without the leadership of that executive director. And I think, from my point of view, that's the analogy that I would use in the case of the fire department. There are some super volunteers in this town. I think that Cape Elizabeth has probably a higher level of volunteerism than most communities enjoy. But it is getting tougher all the time. And I think it would be a grievous mistake to do this without a great deal of consideration. And I hope that that service does not have to be cut. I think that all of us have to expect some diminishment probably of services as we go along. And I know that you'll do the best for the entire town. Thank you very much.
My name is Frank Potenzo, Ivy Road. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth 33 years. Michael McGovern is a tax and pension consultant. And a week or so ago, he furnished the town council with quite a detailed report, which I have a copy of here, of tax facts, council manager charter, abstracts from the 88 Cape Town audit, school board duties, buying treasury securities, the meaning of cash management account, repos, which are repurchase agreements, and a lot of press items on safe trust accounts. One thing that a town manager mentioned was a shortfall on income for the town from investments. And in Mr. Maroon's survey of questions here, he wanted to know why the town manager appointed the business manager of the school board to act as treasurer by investing the town funds in certificates of deposit or other uninsured accounts without the knowledge of the town council, and also investing in repos, which I understand earn 5% interest rate and are not guaranteed, when they could have been invested directly or through one of the banks into treasury notes that pay 7%. That's just one question. I have a lot of questions here, but no answers. Why are Cape Elizabeth funds at risk in the event certain banks are not solvent? Why is more than $4 million in unsecured investments, according to a recent statement by the town manager? You all have copies of this, and I, rather than my reading them, perhaps some of you would like to make comments on these questions in this quite detailed report that Mr. Maroon gave each of you, and right from his heart and his interest in Cape Elizabeth, he feels and I feel that there are a lot of places that money can be saved without making a lot of cuts. So that's all I have to say, and if any of you would like to bring to light this report that Mr. Maroon gave you and answer some of those questions, I think that the residents that are here would like to hear some of those questions and answers, and also the general public that may be watching on television. I think it'd be most interesting. Thank you very much.
Mr. McGovern, would you like to respond to some of the questions that Mr. Maroon posed?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. I should mention that I know Mr. Maroon has been concerned for quite some time, and I know a number of people have encouraged him to come in and speak to me. And, you know, I would certainly hope that he would do so at his earliest convenience so that we can have a good explanation of the various issues. On the particular issues, I think the first one mentioned, or maybe these aren't in any certain order, is why was the business manager of the school department assigned the responsibility for the investment of municipal funds without the knowledge of the town council. In fact, that was with the full knowledge of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. In about 2 years ago, the auditors of the town recommended a reorganization of the way the town set up its financial system so that there would be better segregation of responsibilities as is generally recommended in generally accepted accounting principles. On October 21st, 1988, gave the town council a memorandum outlining the way that could be implemented. The town council at their November 1988 meeting in three separate items approved that change, assigning the business manager the responsibility for investing municipal funds. So it isn't in fact true that that was done without the knowledge of the council. On the issue of repos at 5% repurchase agreements, I have no idea where Mr. Maroon got that information. You know, I think if he or any citizen would like to come in and see our investment records, they're more than welcome to do so. But I don't know of any funds other than those that are in a cash management fund, which overflows at our general checking account, any funds that are in repurchase agreements at 5%. We do have some funds in repurchase agreements, but they're up in the 8%, 7% range. They're approximately 50 basis points less than our other investments. And that's a generally accepted way of doing business with all municipalities. So we don't have any in funds invested at 5%. On the third point on the banks that we're doing business with and whether or not funds are at significant risk, over the last 5 or so years, as we've become concerned about the viability of different financial institutions, we have tried to put our funds in financial institutions that we have watched very closely and that we believe to be are secure. Unfortunately, over time, we've had a diminishing number of financial institutions that fit that particular qualification. All of our funds have been invested on the basis of number one, safety, number two, liquidity, and number three, return on investment. Using those criteria, we eventually found ourselves in just primarily two financial institutions, KeyBank, which is recognized to be the strongest bank probably in the Northeast, and Fleet Bank, which most analysts indicate is the strongest bank in New England. You know, unfortunately, you know, we all pick up the paper and see even Fleet Bank is having some relatively small layoffs and is looking at the particular budgets. Back last August, the auditors recommended that we ought to continue the practice that we're now doing, and that is to get to know banks very carefully, to get to know the financial institutions we're dealing with very carefully, and to seek full protection and security of the funds. We've been doing that process. The amount that is now in collateralized funds, in repurchase agreements in the 7 to 8% range has been reduced in about half. That process will be completed between now and March 15th. The reason we're not completing it before then is we still feel that these two particular institutions are in pretty good shape, and we don't want to be in a position of breaking a certificate of deposit and losing investment income that could help us substantially with the financial situation that we're now facing. You know, I think it's easy to say that, you know, maybe 6 months ago, 9 months ago, or today, we ought to have our funds fully secure. However, when you move to that level of security, you end up paying for it with a reduction on your return on investment. And I feel very comfortable with the job that has been done with investments. I really think it was done in the best interest of the community, and I believe it's continuing to be done in the best interest of the community. Unfortunately, at this point, I recognize it does need to be done. We are losing some of the return on our investment. Did I answer all the questions?
Yes, I think, and quite well. And I'll take responsibility for perhaps stirring up a hornet's nest as a consequence of one of the newspaper reporters quoting me personally, indicating that at the time I made a comment with respect to some of our funds that were not collateralized and that were not in repos, were at significant risk. Significant, my word. I think it's a relative word, and I think it was a word that has caused the town manager a tremendous amount of extra work and aggravation. And I apologize publicly for making that comment in a public forum. As the finance chair, I have complete confidence in the town manager under the current circumstances of making the necessary moves that simply have to be made now. They couldn't have been made 6 months ago. But I, for one, of the council have complete confidence in what we're doing, and I'll be delighted as of March 15, 1991, when we have all of our funds in a insured fashion. But again, I'll only echo the town manager's point, that has cost us about $67,000. That's a lot of money for safety. But at the present time, I think it's necessary to take a hit in that direction as a consequence of, as you know, banks failing here and there.
Thank you. Is there anyone else from the
Madam
public?
Chairman.
Yes, Councilor Jordan.
I would just like to add a couple of things to that. Mike Maroon called me about this a little while ago when the roof fell in. And it's pretty easy for somebody to start picking on us when somebody's name gets involved. And at the time this was set up, we was all very confident in who was going to handle the investments. And it was overseen by the manager, and they discussed it back and forth. So I, as one councilor, felt it was very excellent way to go, and I think we had a good handle on it. And as far as when I talked to him, as far as whether the CDs were, I told him at that time, as fast as they were going to come due, they were going to be put in a safer deposits, either treasury bills or repos. And it would have cost us more money if we started dragging them in before they were due, and we was better off, in my opinion, to write it out. And I told him that at the time, and I'm quite surprised that he went in such detail here. Thank you.
I just wondered if anybody in the public was going to respond to the two questions that Wayne posed at the beginning of this public hearing, which were, do people feel that we as a council should be setting a target this year as to what the maximum tax increase should be, at least on a percentage basis? We've never done that before until we really get into the details of looking at everybody's budget. Last year we said we will not go into double-digit increases. What we've been talking about this year is setting some target before we get into the budget debate. Is there anybody here that is interested in speaking to that issue, or do you think that that's an impossible task to do at this point?
Herbert Dennison.
Excuse me. Do all the people leaving think it's impossible? Is that why you're leaving? Or
they don't pay taxes.
They're all scared of you, Herb.
Can I show of hands or something?
I guess I got B.O.
For the audience at home, it's the high school civics class who sits in on our meetings.
Herbert Dennison, 63, Spelmack Avenue, 50 years. In answer to your question, Mr. Quinn, I think you should have a target of no increase. The way the economy is gone, the way private industry is, the way times are today, I know you're going to be under a lot of pressure. You may end up with an increase, but your answer to the school department, the looseness, the way they handle, and the way they dislike answering to the people, the way the roof is still leaking, the way we've spent money that wasn't accountable in the budget that was in there, I don't know why you should give them a figure. Maybe you should give them a cut, but that's when I get to discuss the school department. On the town side, I think our manager's projections prove the economy, and I don't think there should be anything sacred. The fire department has done a great job before they had a full-time chief. They've done a great job since they've had a full-time chief. I don't mean to pick on the fire department, but if it takes people, it takes people. If we have to wait a year on our equipment or two, the way the recession is, same with the police department, public works, if it takes bodies, I think you're going to have to look at people by looking at your figures. I would also question that you ought to relook at your business manager and his credibility now with all the light that's come to, facts that's come to light here and the way some of your school business has been done. your theory was good to start with, maybe with helping the manager invest or the treasurer, however you want to word it. But there certainly has been a lot of unanswered questions to date to the people, I feel. Mr. Maroon, I think, has some good points there of guidelines. And I don't think it should be anything or anybody's sacred. I think you're going to have to look at it that way. And I don't think our school system is that superior or that good, personally. So, yes, I think you should be looking at no increase. You may end up with one, but I don't care what you put out there for a figure. It'll go above it. Always does.
Is there anyone else who'd like to come forward? Are we going to have...
I neglected to comment that Mike Maroon could not be here. He unexpectedly had to go to Burlington, Vermont. And that was just several hours ago. And if that had not occurred, he would be here asking all these questions himself. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Potenza. If there's no one else who wants to come forward, we'll close this part of the public hearing. And go on to another public hearing. Item 108, to consider acknowledging public comments on the upcoming fiscal year 1992 budget process and budget projections and take any necessary action. Councilors?
Madam Chairman, I would move that we acknowledge the comments that have been given to us this evening. As no formal action is required, all we will do is acknowledge the comments. My expectation is that we can soon begin our deliberations with the school board and among ourselves and try to get into the specifics of the 92 budget sooner than we were able to last year.
Second the motion.
Any further comments? All in favor? 7-0. The next is a public hearing with Caputa Club for full-time spiritus and vinous malt liquor license and special amusement permit. Deborah Pizzo will give us the background, please.
Thank you. The council has before it tonight a request from the Caputa Club for their renewal application of their liquor license and special amusement permit. You have before you the application, which is complete. The public hearing tonight has been properly advertised. Excuse me, this item is ready for council action.
Thank you. Is there anyone from Caputa Club who is present? Wants to make a comment? No? Would you like to come forward and make a comment, or you're just showing that you're a member? Okay, fine. Thank you. Then we'll close the public part of the hearing and move on to item number 109, to consider granting the Caputa Club a full-time spiritus and vinous malt liquor license and special amusement permit and take any necessary action.
Madam Chairman, I move that the license be granted.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? 7-0 vote. Item number 110, to consider a recommendation from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission regarding amendments to the Statement of Uses of Fort Williams Park and take any necessary action. Is there someone from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission here?
Committee will be right here.
Oh, okay. We're just a little bit too speedy for them today. Mr. Blood?
Clint, don't sit down. Come right to the podium.
We're on, yes, we've already introduced the item number 109, the statement of uses.
Those are the two people
The reason for the statement of uses for Fort Williams Park was we in the past several years have been having an increased number of people that have desired to use the park. And as you know, the goal of the park is to maintain the park so all members or residents of Cape Elizabeth can use it whenever they would like to. And we really felt that there was a need to reuse or redo the statement of use of the Fort Williams Park, so we made several changes and recommendations to the town council. You have copies of that, and underlined, some of the major changes are that the town manager would have the ability to approve use of the park for groups that do not exceed 150 people, and if groups were in excess of 150 people, that meant they had to come to the Fort Williams Commission. If, in fact, the groups needed to use an exclusive use of the park, with the exception of the picnic shelter, they would be required to come to the Fort Williams Park. For example, if, in fact, a group wanted to come in and use the Ball Diamond and want to have exclusive use of the Ball Diamond, even if they only had 25 people, they would have to come to the Fort Williams Commission to have that reserved for them. If a group was coming in and they felt their numbers were going to be less than 150, wanted to use the Ball Diamond but did not require exclusive usage, so if someone else was there before them, they had a perfect right to use that Ball Diamond, then they would not have to come before our group or the town manager. This happens basically all the time as we stand now. Any groups under 150 people that are requesting use of the park on weekends during the summer, basically from Memorial Day, we say from June 1 to October 1st, but we're looking at Memorial Day, then they would have to also come before the commission, because during the summer on weekends, there's a tremendous number of people that use the park, and we do not encourage having special activities at the park on weekends. And then any group that would advertise their event to the general public would have to come before the Fort Williams Commission. The other areas of concern have been, and we really want to just establish the criteria of priorities in terms of usage of the park, and we wanted the groups, the town of Cape Elizabeth and the Cape Elizabeth school system would have priority over any other group as far as the park is concerned. The second area would be such groups like Little League would be the second criteria. So if Little League desires to use the park on Family Fun Day, then Family Fun Day has priority over Little League, as an example. Then the traditional events such as the symphony would be the third area of criteria, and the fourth area would be other special activities. We felt that this was put down in a usage form, it would help out dramatically in terms of any conflicts that might arise in the future. We also have had some concern in terms of the number of cars that might come into a particular event. As you know, this is a reaction to what happened last in July with the symphony. We can basically park about 1,300 cars in the fort, and we don't want the fort to be used in such a manner that it would have excessive wear on the fort. So we are certainly not in favor of having large groups coming into the fort on a constant basis and then parking their cars, thus causing a lot of wear on the fort. And then we're also obviously asking the town council to have the final decision regarding the use of the, you know, of our recommendations. There is one change, though, in a sense, is that the town manager on groups which do not come before the town, before the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, actually has the final approval on the smaller groups. And we feel that's fine because there are just large numbers. We'd be meeting constantly if we had every group that called in. And I sometimes will get people calling in, as I did this week, which I then turned over to the town manager to make the decision regarding the uses of the park. The other area is involves fees. We in the past have had a fee structure for groups. This is not a fee structure for general admission to the park, but basically a fee structure for those groups that are using the fort. And if it's a vehicle-intensive group, we're recommending that the per-vehicle charge be changed from $1 per vehicle to $2 a vehicle. If it's a people-intensive organization, then we recommend the change be from 25 cents to $1 per person. The other areas would stay the same. For those people who might like to know how else we collect fees, we either have a combination of a vehicle or people-intensive group, or we also charge a 5% of gross ticket sales. The other concern we have is that the actual taking in of the fees is not the responsibility of the town, in the sense that parking fees are not up to the town to have to collect those. And we would like very much for those fees, if at all possible, to be part of a general ticket and not have to be collected when you just as you come into the fort. We feel this would cut down, especially, for example, the symphony would cut down some of the traffic congestion that occurred this past year. Basically, in all the other areas, we've left the statement of uses to be the same, but we do feel that this will better delineate the responsibilities that the commission has versus the town manager versus the council, as well as changing the fee structure, which would be more appropriate for the use of the park.
Thank
Any
you.
Questions?
Any questions from councilors? Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. Clint, did the Fort Williams Advisory Commission have a public hearing prior to coming to developing these proposed amendments?
No.
Okay, that's one thing I'm wondering if the council may want to consider having a public hearing on these. Maybe in the course of our discussion we can make that determination. I'm wondering, Clint, if you're saying that groups under 150 persons requesting a weekend activity between June 1 and October 1 would need to come before the commission, if you really want that to be Memorial Day, let's say Memorial Day, because that can be quite a few days before June 1, you know, if, mm-hmm. if that was your intent. That
That's would the, be basically the intent is Memorial Day weekend.
Memorial Day weekend.
Weekend, because that is a very large usage of the fort at that time.
Okay, I think
that I agree.
If that is the intent, that's the way it better be worded for you. When you talk about traditional events that have been held at the fort, that they would be in your priority list, they'd be number 3 on the priority list. You mentioned Symphony, which has the summer concerts there that we all enjoy so much. How often does an event have to have been held to now be considered traditional? If a group had been there once, are they? Yeah, I'm just trying to pose a few things.
In our terminology, we were thinking of the ones we have, which we consider quite traditional. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Family Fun Day, and that's covered, and graduation is covered mm-hmm. earlier. The Engine One Art Fair, as an example, we would consider as being quite traditional. Obviously, the symphony is traditional. But those are the major usages of the park. We, for example, this year had a car show that was very successful the weekend after Labor Day, I believe. Mm-hmm. That was one year. Whether you consider that traditional being next year being traditional, I have a question regarding that. But I would think several years in a row, they should certainly have a priority over someone just coming in the first year.
That's what I was hoping.
Yeah, it's not a one year.
Okay. I'm also wondering if you solicited or received any input from some of the groups about the proposed increase in fees.
The only group that I have talked with has been the Symphony. Mm-hmm. I think there's some realization that they may need to be paying a little bit more. I obviously would like not to, of course. But I do believe in what's been set forth is something that they probably can live with in okay. terms of the fee increase, which will certainly affect them more than any other group in terms of actual dollars coming to the town.
Right, I would expect so. Okay. Just a curiosity question on my part. Is there a kind of information sheet that either you or the town has that tells when your commission meets? If a group is trying to plan an event, they realize they've got to go to the commission rather than through the manager. Would they get that information just by a call to town hall, or do you have an information sheet outlining the other than this, outlining the
okay.
process?
Okay. Now, all the groups have to go through the town manager at first, because the town manager brings those to the commission. So we, on our schedule, for example, our next meeting is January 10th. So we have not set a meeting up in February. We generally meet on a monthly basis, mm-hmm. but we don't have it set up further than that. But the groups that called this week, for example, can't make it January 10th, and I said I'd be back in touch with them in February and to contact Mike, because he would know when our meeting is in February.
Okay. And just one of those touchy questions we've dealt with in the past few years, you say that town events and school events are number one priority. You're anticipating my question, I can tell.
Yes.
Is that listed the way it is for a reason? The town being first?
No, I don't think that was.
Okay. I'm wondering about family fun day and graduation.
We anticipate graduation being June 14th and family fun day being June 15th.
Okay. It's fine.
It has not come to us yet, but we hope it will be.
Has worked in the past. I know it's been a major concern to a lot of people, but we've seen it work in the past. And I think especially if those two events can work cooperatively, we can continue the dates that we've had traditionally. Thank you.
Questions from other counselors? May I make just a slight suggestion as to changing some of wording on the top of the second page where you talk about the parking vehicle capacity, unless alternative off-site parking arrangements have been made, instead of agreed to, instead of ending the sentence?
Been made, yeah.
Proposition. I've been on the ordinance committee, I can't help it. Would that be acceptable?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Other comments? If not, I'll take a motion. Councilor Amaral.
Yeah, I do have a comment and then a motion. I think these proposed changes seem very reasonable, well thought out, and they make a whole lot of sense. Councilor McLaughlin's idea that maybe we might want to set this to public hearing just in case there's anything we as a council have overlooked or that Fort Williams Committee might have overlooked. I don't see any harm. I don't think there's any rush during the winter months to get this through. So I would propose that we set this for a public hearing at our next meeting in January.
Second.
January 10th?
14th.
At 7:30.
Councilor Jordan.
I have one comment that I'm concerned, and I hope that you've looked into the ticket deal as far as collecting the $2 so they don't get into collecting at the gate type deal. And I think that should be pointed out very strongly so you don't run into those traffic problems. I know you touched on it, but that is something that's going to be taken into consideration quite heavily, I would think, so they get their advance sales and people can get right in.
Yes, we've actually been in contact with the Symphony, which is the primary person or group that's had the concerns, and we hopefully this next year will not have people backed up to State Street in Portland trying to get into Fort Williams.
All those in favor of the motion to set this for public hearing January 14th at 7:30? 7-0. Thank you, Clint, and your committee. Your excellent, continued excellent work. Item number 111, to consider a proposed master plan for Fort Williams Park and take any necessary action. Mr. Blood, do you want to give us some background? This is quite an extensive plan called a master plan.
Yes, it's really with a great deal of pleasure and pride that I stand before you this evening regarding the master plan on behalf of the Fort Williams Commission. Somewhat a year and a half ago, et cetera, when we, or you agreed to, for our, at our request to establish a master plan, and that result is what you have in front of you this evening. I'd like to, first off, to really thank a large number of people who have been involved in this master plan. First off, I certainly want to thank Terry and Architects. One of the things that I have noticed being involved with the Fort Williams Commission is everyone seems to give 110% or 150%. It's just absolutely amazing. And I can certainly say, Terrians, if you look at what our cost was, this just is phenomenal what we've gotten back. And I really want to take this time to thank George and Tom, who are here this evening, who will be following up on my sort of summary in more detail regarding the report. And it's interesting, George came to our meeting, everybody has stories. I won't tell his story, but he may want to tell his story about Fort Williams, but everyone has a story, and he served on this commission. I don't know if he were chairman, he was chairman also, so even though he left Cape Elizabeth, he did turn it over to able hands of Tom Emery to carry on, so. Some other people I really would like to thank publicly are Bob Malley and Mike McGovern for their support, because there's been an awful lot of time spent on this, and if it wasn't for their help and guidance, it would have been much more difficult. And I certainly wanted to take the time to thank my fellow commissioners, Ann Kerner, Dick Walker, Randall Wilde, Joan Ralston, Carolyn Smith, and Nancy Jackson, for the amount of hours that they have spent on meetings, traipsing around Fort Williams, going over to Tarion's, taking time off, just going over individually and giving input into this and just talking with people in general regarding the input as far as this plan is concerned. And certainly last but not least, I want to thank the Town Council for its support and just allowing us to have this plan, which I think will really bode well for the future as far as the Fort Williams is concerned. For those people who might like to understand why we have to have a master plan of Fort Williams, is that it came about because we realized that there's a potential limitation of resources available to maintain this park, while at the same time, we realized the park is being pressured for a variety of reasons with increased usage. And we really just didn't want to be spending money and enhancing areas of the park only to find out that several years later we might have to change that or tear it down. So we looked at various areas in this master plan. And they are park philosophy, erosion control, landscaping, reforestation, pedestrian and vehicular traffic flow, and parking. One of the first things I'd like to comment on is in all of our studies and talks, the policy statement developed in 1976 is just as appropriate today in 1990 as it was in 1976. Nearly everyone that we talk with likes the fort the way it is. They would like to see maybe a few things enhanced, but we certainly don't want the fort changed. So I'd like to read the policy statement, because I think it really hits the essence of what Fort Williams is. Quote, this comes from the 1976 policy statement. Fort Williams is a unique community resource which has irreplaceable scenic, natural, and historical qualities. As such, it should be dedicated to predominantly park, recreational, and cultural uses, which uses preserve or enhance and are otherwise fully compatible with its unique qualities in which uses are within the financial capabilities of the town. We see no reason to change that statement. We then set out to look how we could finance and the recommendations as far as the master plan are concerned. Basically, the areas of concern were first off safety, second was need, and third was cost. The areas of safety that we felt most concerned about dealt with the parade ground parking lot because people are backing out into traffic flow, and we were concerned with the area by the beach area where the road narrows and people walk along the beach area. Those are the two areas that were of great concern from a safety standpoint. From a need standpoint, we realized that there's going to be increased need for parking because of the museum. Many people will be staying longer at the park than they have in the past because of the museum. This is going to mean for a greater need for parking areas. There is also a substantial need for erosion control and reforestation projects. We then put these projects from a standpoint of cost. And if, in fact, our budget were to continue at $50,000 to $60,000 a year, we felt that we could do this in a four-year plan. Now, we realize the total cost is way above that $50,000 or $60,000 a year. So we've developed four other areas to develop funds. And as Councillor Coggeshall probably has already noted, there is a couple of typos in the sentence just before that. It should not, in the statement with the paragraph starting, it should be noted, if you look further down, it should be noted that the cost of these projects is substantially greater than $50,000 to $60,000 per year, but the Commission is looking for additional sources of funding which should not impact the taxpayers of Cape Elizabeth. These sources include but are not limited to, not there's a by there, it should be a T instead of a Y. And the four areas that we see developing funds outside of the taxpayers would be, number one, a newly developed Fort Williams Park Trust, of which you are the trustees. We understand that money has already been, there is some monies already have been donated to that trust as we stand here tonight. Number two, the Maine National Guard. We have been in touch with the Maine National Guard, and they're looking to work in the fort, in specifically the areas of parking development, and they could train and help us out at the same time. They would provide all of the equipment. We would have to provide the different materials, but they have the machinery and the manpower for that. And I think Mr. McGovern has been in touch with the National Guard even as late as today regarding their interest in helping us out. Number three, Southern Maine Technical College, working with Rick Churchill. We understand that there may be an opportunity to have them help us with erosion control. The Maine National Guard does no erosion control or landscaping, but Southern Maine Technical College may be able to be of help to us in that area. The fourth area deals with the Portland Headlight Keepers Quarters Museum. And this would be the museum's cost would be its share of developing the parking area attributable to the museum usage. And this essentially would be phase one and possibly phase two of the central parking area. And Tarion Architects will discuss that in greater detail. I don't know, I won't go over which in front of you what we projected for the first 4 years, but in column number two on the second page, an area which we feel of great concern with, and this is something really totally different than we've done in the past, has been the development of a preservation area within the park that is not bordering the coast. We all know that the area along the coast is a special preservation area. We cannot develop that at all. Not that we're looking to develop the Chapel Road area, which is the area closest to Surf Road, or the Officers Row area, but we do feel that those two areas need public recognition, that they really are an important area of the park, and that we should put emphasis on those areas to develop those areas and maintain those areas. For example, Officers Row, most of the trees are of the same age. If something should happen to oak trees, we'd have absolutely no forest or any shade at all in that whole area. The Chapel Road area is absolutely gorgeous if any of you have walked that area, but it needs a lot of work in terms of landscaping and some tree work definitely needs to be done in that area without encouraging people to would hurt the buffers on Surf Road. That lends into our last point, is that the commission really feels that the existing buffer between the park and its neighbors should be controlled and enhanced. We believe a landscaping program should be developed to ensure neighbor compatibility. We have a number of people who live beside the fort, and we need to make sure that they can have peaceful and enjoy their homes, and we do believe that a better landscaping would promote that buffer between them and the park. All in all, we really feel that this report is just a tremendous step forward for the park, and that really the park represents the heart and soul of Cape Elizabeth, and this master plan will really be an important part of enhancing that in our lives and the lives of the people that will follow us in the years ahead. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to turn it over to George Tarion and Tom Emery, who will go into more detail regarding the fort, and then be happy to answer any of your questions. George?
Council Chair Cogshall, members of the council, I am very pleased to be here before you this evening on the subject of Fort Williams Park. And I am particularly pleased on a personal note to look around the room and see the number of familiar faces from the days when I was a resident of Cape Elizabeth, and to note that the momentum of the wheels of democracy in the Cape continues undiminished. And Chairman Clint, I thank you for your expression of appreciation for the work that Tarion Architects has put in with the committee on this report and plan, but the credit is profoundly due to the involvement and commitment of the members of the committee in the resource which you all quite properly pride so much. I am going to turn over the microphone in a moment to Tom Emery, a vice president at Tarion Architects, who heads up our landscape architecture department, and to whom the responsibility for preparing this plan fell, and to whom much of the credit should also go for its very good content. But I think it's appropriate to take just a moment to talk about how the present time, which is well into the second decade of the town's commitment to the park for recreational use, has matured in the way in which the town looks at the kinds of decisions that we have incidentally experienced as the commission and the council and the town have been addressing the kinds of day-to-day decisions on the use and administration of the park. And it is, I think, a unique resource to have a community take over a piece of property like this and in a relatively short time turn it into the very strong resource that not only suits and serves the citizens of the town and, of course, of the larger community and of visitors from around the world, but that takes a special place in our hearts as something which has an identity that really is, as you put it, at the heart and spirit of Cape Elizabeth. So with special pleasure, I introduce Tom Emery to you, who is no stranger, of course, being still a resident of Cape Elizabeth and even involved in the planning board, to take you through the specifics of the plan. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Lady Chairman, councilors, fellow citizens, I guess I know how Ed Drynan feels now. I think Clint has provided an excellent introduction to the master plan. I, in turn, would like to thank the committee, the manager, Bob Malley, and someone who's absent tonight, Bob Metcalf, who is a landscape architect who worked considerably on the master plan report. Bob is with John Mitchell's office now, and we wish him well. But a lot of his influence from Penn State University is obviously in the site analysis portion and the management portion of this report, and we thank him very much for that. In a rare political inspiration, maybe a year and a half ago, I attended a neighborhood meeting of the council, and the issue of Fort Williams came up, and one thing that rang clear with everyone who stood up was, don't screw it up. Here's a tremendous resource. You don't have to plant too many flowers. You don't have to do too much. Just let the resource be maintained and preserved for future generations. And we've taken that to heart. And I think for those people who aren't familiar with the graphics of the master plan, on first blush, it really doesn't appear to be very different than what's already there. And I think that's essentially the way we wanted it, the way the committee and Terry and architects worked together and directed it. What I will do for the benefit, I guess, of people who aren't here and who may be viewing at home, and particularly for the people who have not had the benefit of going through the report, there is a tremendous amount of analysis work and graphics in the report that are a lot more than just this plan. This plan is done to provide sort of a final product. But the purpose of the master plan is really as a benchmark and a working document is to be molded and massaged and really to continue to meet the town's need. It's not a hard and fast plan that be used as a construction document. So with that, what I'll do is quickly go down Clint's list by project, by year, and just generally show on the plan where those improvements are shown. And for those of you who have a report, this is under the master plan section, the illustrative plan. Let me just orient you here. The bottom of the plan is Shore Road, Casco Bay, obviously at the top. The headlight is located here, and the main entrance to the park is here, Ship Cove, and north is toward the council. Year one, we're talking about a boardwalk. Again, the purpose of that is to provide a safe pedestrian connection between Ship Cove and the rest of the park. General observation has been that many people using the park tend to just simply drive in, come up to the Portland headlight, either park and look out, take a couple of spins around, and then drive out. And that's a very legitimate use of the park, and because of the earlier network of roads being provided, it will continue to work fairly well that way. But we also feel that it's very important that pedestrians be able to get from point A to point B without a lot of interference with the traffic. One of the other major items is erosion control work. I made an effort to get out here during this storm last week, and that gave me pause when I look back on our erosion control recommendations. There are some things that we will not control when it comes to erosion. You have to be there to appreciate it. It's just absolutely phenomenal, the power of the ocean. But there are areas along, particularly along the tops of the cliffs, that were indeed above the wave action, where people walking along the edges continue to compact the soil, and eventually the vegetation is killed. And then through rainstorms and ice action, those areas are lost. We would like to see those areas fenced off with a snow fence and revegetated, and probably having to be fenced off for several years. The other item was the expansion of the parade ground parking lot. That involves several areas. First of all, just as you pull into the parade ground, we're proposing that about 8 cars along this stretch will be eliminated so that no one is backing out into the main access road. Being a veteran T-ball parent, I know this parking lot very well, and the way it's used now is there are people park on both sides, although there really is only room on one side. People taking their chances of going over the hill. The other way is parallel parking, and then when it's really crowded, people use the cul-de-sac and parallel park in there, so the only way out of the lot is to back up. What we're proposing to do is expand the width of the lot so that you can double load the parking lot, continue the lot up toward the parade ground, toward the west, and hopefully keep the cul-de-sac free so that people are able to come up, drop off equipment, and then continue back and find a parking space. We will initially lose 8 spaces near the shore road, but the parking will be expanded ultimately up to about 74 spaces. In fiscal year 92, we're looking at the new central parking lot. This lot was proposed as a response to elimination of parking in front of the keeper's quarters and the lighthouse. If you look in the report, there are a couple of sketches, but really the issue is here is that people come from all over the country to get a view of this lighthouse, and as they arrive here, I've never seen the Alamo, but I hear the Alamo is somewhat like this. You see an ocean of asphalt in front of you. And more to the point, it's very, very confusing and perhaps dangerous within that parking lot. So as we eliminate some of the parking there, we're proposing to relocate it away from the keeper's quarter, but provide a pleasant walking experience and to generally phase that in a couple of phases so it won't have an immediate impact on the park. We'll begin reforestation of Officers Row. That will include an inventory of the existing vegetation, hopefully on a good survey plan, and then a gradual replacement of the overstory with some smaller trees. That's a very gradual reforestation program. And the development of the Portland headlight lot. We have met with Rick Renner, and I've just spoken with Henry again about the multiple needs here. One, we really identified as people coming out on Sunday afternoon as we all get older and less able to get around. That's a real nice place where people can get a view of the ocean without having to be ambulatory. It also allows for the people who are just going to come out, they can drive around this loop. And as well, hopefully enough spaces that so people can stay here for maybe 5 or 10 minutes, use the gift shop and come back. There will be probably about 5 spaces that will be needed for the keeper's quarter and the gift shop, and we'll have to look at that in a little more detail as to how those people are accommodated. We're also providing in this large loop areas for bus drop-off so that the buses will come out, offload passengers, and either quickly passengers will go and shop and come back on, or they can come to the central parking lot, and there's a large turnaround, and in the first phase, parking for 4 buses there as well. Parenthetically, I should say that rather than doing an elaborate study of parking demand and the acreage of the park and potential visitors, what we have done is very gradually phased in parking so that we can analyze or the commission can assess the impact of those additional parking spaces over time and really let the character of the park determine how many people should continue to be parked there. The other projects in the future phases that are identified is reclamation of the pond. Rather than rebuild, there are two sets of stone walls there. There's an upper set of stone walls and a lower set. There was a cost estimate done years ago, which was in the millions of dollars, to rebuild both walls. We'll simply clear out the bottom of the pond, use the lower wall as riprap, set it in place, and then rebuild some of the upper wall, repair the stairs, and sort of create a fragment of that wall and somewhat of a ruin. There will be improvements proposed around the power plant. Some of those seem to be already underway. And improving the pathway that goes behind the power plant. Small item, but a very important item, is the Ship Cove Beach parking lot area. Right now, there's no real handicapped accessibility from that lot. We'll be providing both a turnout so that the last cars parked in that lot are able to back out and head out, and we think that'll reduce a lot of the congestion that's there now, as well as provide handicapped access for people. There is a concrete pad there that has picnic benches on it, and we'll provide ready access to that area, and as well as out to Battery Keys. The other area for handicapped accessibility is at the end of Harrison Road. There's already an existing island there. We'll park cars or vans there, and then they can cross at a designated crosswalk and use Battery Knoll. And lastly, we have the future expansion of the central parking lot as appropriate and as demand may dictate, and that second phase will be about 100 automobiles. Chapel Road reforestation, very similar to what will happen with Officers Row, and implementation of the park buffer north and south and along Shore Road, infill of areas. Also, for the general, for the benefit of the viewers and the public, the site analysis portion of the report dealt with issues of erosion. We looked at pedestrian circulation, vehicular circulation, inventoried all of the existing parking spaces. We looked at the configuration of those spaces. For example, at the picnic shelter parking lot, we're showing in the master plan an area that isn't very much larger than the original gravel lot, but just by reconfiguration and actually showing those spaces, we can get quite a few more cars in there. And a very detailed evaluation of the existing vegetation. And I just want to speak briefly about the maintenance program that's in the master plan report, working with Bob Malley. I don't think anyone is really looking to a day when this is going to be a pristine garden. It will be maintained in many different ways. We've listed all of those ways in the report. But just for example, these yellow-green areas here we refer to as the meadow, the parade ground, Battery Knoll, and the green in this area are maintained with weekly cuttings, whereas other areas of the park, what we refer to as the southwest quadrant, we allow to continue in successional growth, which is really just the existing vegetation continuing to grow. And perhaps at some future time, we can create a multi-purpose field here that I believe is already has a designated name, but we'll leave that as a surprise to the future. I do want to briefly talk to the issue of the Goddard Mansion. That was certainly one of Bob Metcalf's pet projects, as was the multi-purpose field, I think Dick Sawyer's pet project. But that's just between myself and Dick. We have the remnant garden area. There is a lot of existing vegetation behind the Goddard Mansion. I know Penny Carson has been very busy, has done a lot of work in this area with volunteers, as well as the area in front, what we refer to as the lawn, can certainly be renovated. And in terms of implementation, Clint, I think, has covered that very well, so I really won't go into any detail other than to say how pleased we are that we were able to propose and have it accepted the notion of the preservation areas, so that there is, we hope and trust, a guarantee that as our children and grandchildren return to Fort Williams over the years, they will experience a very similar environment to that which we enjoy today and which is so important to the park. And lastly, but certainly not least, is the Girl Scout Council area. It was an area that we're really looking at as a future improvement. We show a turnaround at the end of Humphrey Road. When I was out there last week during the storm, all the traffic was being redirected and everybody was going in all kinds of directions to get turned around. This is an opportunity for people who come to the dead end of the park, so to speak, who really don't have any place else to go other than down the service lanes, to easily get turned around and head back in the other direction. With that, I'll say thank you, and George and I, and Clint, I'm sure, will be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Get you let you get away with a slur in the Alamo. I was there recently. It's not that bad a visual experience. They have some special pavers in front of the Alamo, but I'm glad you paid attention to the visual experience of the headlight. I do want to make one comment just so people, it seems to me like you've gotten a year ahead of yourselves here. I want to know if I'm accurate in saying right now we're in fiscal year 91. So I believe what you're proposing for fiscal year 91 would really be for fiscal year 92. I'd add a year to all of your fiscal year projections. Unless you plan expending right now.
You know, once this plan is adopted in the whatever format it's eventually adopted, in, within the Fort Williams budget for this year, there was a small amount that was unallocated. So, you know, the hope is that maybe some of these things could be started, particularly once it's known how much will be available next year to see if some things could be worked together, particularly, I think, as Clint mentioned, with the National Guard assistance. So there could be a little bit of funds provided with a lot of voluntary labor that would not run into a lot of dollars.
So you're saying they're on target with their what's in
here? No, I think obviously with the presentation earlier this evening, you know, you're going to have to look at implementation of any plan the community has for anything in terms of the budget realities.
Thank you. I've worked on master plans before, and I have to say this has all the elements of a wonderful master plan. There's been a lot of hard work, there's been a lot of detailed work, you can tell reading through this. You've had a lot of input, you've paid attention to the neighbors, which is always real important, and reading through it, people said, oh, it just makes such good sense. You have a very successful product here, and I commend all of you who have worked on this. Good job.
Ms. Stepley.
Yes, I would also wonder, you know, even though it's a very special jewel to all of us who live in Cape Elizabeth, there are many awards that are given for, you know, public-private partnerships. I know the National League of Cities gives a particular award each year for that, and I would wonder about the worthwhileness of entering this particular plan. It's just such an extraordinary job. I would ask if the town manager might look into some of the criteria for these items. Not only would it be an honor for the town, but sometimes there's a nice little cash prize to go along with it, which wouldn't hurt.
I'd be happy to once the council adopts it, but not
embarrassing
to send
an
it
award
in
first.
And say it wasn't adopted.
It goes without saying.
Any other comments, councilors? Okay, we have
one comment.
Yes.
I had a question. Something. Is there a difference between a preserve and a reserve?
Yes. We
referred. I should just back up a minute. We created a lot of names for different areas in the park just to make it easy as we were discussing areas. We referred to the preserves as Chapel Road and Officers Road. Reserve is the southwest quadrant, and that just is really simply to say that this is an area that is not. We're not proposing any improvements. It's just simply in reserve as it is for future improvement projects or. I do want to apologize. I understand that it is Dick Walker, not Dick Sawyer. Sorry, Tim.
It's Bruce Sawyer.
Councilor Jordan.
I want to welcome George back to Cape Elizabeth. He used to be my neighbor. I considered him as a neighbor years ago. Therefore, I'll say that I believe it is an excellent plan, and I'll move for the adoption.
Second.
Before we act on that motion, could we have a little discussion as to whether or not we want to adopt this at this moment, or whether we want to schedule a workshop or a public hearing and or a public hearing on this plan before we actually adopt it? Comments?
Most often we accept plans the first time,
right,
on the first go around. And I think, I don't know if adopting this commits us to, okay, they're put down as recommendations. Just knowing the budget constraints, I would have a lot of trepidation right now in saying I want to adopt this and have everybody expect the recommendations to become realities. I think we have to be very aware of what's going to happen with this year's budget. And I say this hoping everybody still remembers how much I personally love Fort Williams. I just have to deal with the realities and the political realities and the economic climate that we're living in. I don't know. I mean, I personally would love to say, yeah, let's adopt it. Let's go for it. I don't
Which
know if I can do that.
Which I think we all probably do, but perhaps we want to, if you feel that you want to try to adopt it tonight, that it should be conditioned upon fiscal restraints, or do you want more public input? Do we want to sit down and talk this over section by section more? Councilor Jordan.
When I made the motion for the adoption, I didn't feel that I committed myself to give the Fort Williams Committee X number of dollars, because if you want to change that, I'll go through it and put some up twos in May and whatever in it, and I don't feel that's necessary.
Mr. Tarian.
Excuse me for intruding, but I would like to encourage the council to consider adoption as quite distinct from implementation, that a plan is a statement of desire, of intent, that reflects the work of the committee that has gone on, and implementation becomes the confrontation with the real world. And I would hope that the council could adopt enthusiastically without, as Councillor Jordan points out, feeling attached to every detail in the plan for its implementation. Thank you.
No other comments? Those in favor of adopting the plan as presented tonight, the master plan for Fort Williams?
Enthusiastically.
That's a 7-0. The plan is adopted. It is an excellent plan. And we'll do our best implement as much as possible. Item number 112, to consider setting a public hearing on a proposed amendment to the general assistance regulations regarding maximum rent levels and take necessary action. Manager McGovern will give us the background on this particular item.
Yes, I wasn't very happy with this when I got it. And I, since then, I've discussed it with at least one other manager in another community, and the feeling is that rent levels, rent amounts are going down, and the state's telling us to go up, and it's a little bit of an awkward position. I've spoken to particularly one of the deputy city managers in Portland, who indicated that Portland is intervening with the Department of Human Services to try to get this reduced. So what I would encourage you to do at this point, in spite of my earlier recommendation, is to table it for a period of not to exceed 3 months, and with the understanding is to come back to you.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion.
Madam Chairman, I did just want to make a comment that I talked to two people who rent property in Cape Elizabeth, and they have both confirmed what Mr. McGovern said, that they have lowered their rents to attract tenants. in the past couple months.
Other comments? Councilor Jordan?
Move the question.
All those in favor to table? We're up to 3 months. 7-0. Item 113, to consider acknowledging receipt of the fiscal 1991 fiscal 1996 budget impact schedule and take any necessary action. Michael?
I already spoke quite a bit on this. I think the only other comment I'd like to make is to really again state how helpful the department heads were in preparing this document, and in Barbara Ray as well, for her work in preparing. It's quite an extensive job each year, and I think it has proved to be a useful document in budgetary planning. My only regret is I think that, you know, in looking at it, everything in it is very necessary and desirable, and it's a real disappointment that we're in the situation that we're now in and that we can't move forward on all the things that really do need to be done to serve the citizens of the community.
Other comments from members of the council? There's no hesitation. Okay. All those in favor of, they have a motion on the item, please.
I would move that we acknowledge receipt of the report.
Second.
All in favor? Item number 114, to consider whether or not the fiscal year 1992 budget workshop shall be compensated cable cast and take any necessary action. Michael?
Yes, Councilor Reed spoke to me a couple different times over the last month or so asking whether or not there was a plan to cable cast the budget workshops. You know, in the past it's never been done, and I know when the cable was first set up there was a certain hesitation on whether or not you wanted workshops cable cast, and up to this point it's always been you know, a decision of the council whether or not they would be cable cast. You know, obviously if anyone would like to tape a meeting, they're fully entitled to do so, but if you do want to have the workshops cable cast, you know, specifically request people be there to do it, generally there is a cost for it, and my best guesstimate, and again, it depends on how long they last, and I can't predict those, but it would be approximately $600 for all of them, including the Saturday session, the workshops that you have with the school board, as well as some of the others that might appear during the schedule.
Comments from councilors? Councilor Jordan.
Yes. Thank you. I personally don't think it's necessary to cable cast all the meetings, and maybe one or two with a school or something like that if you want to do it. They're open to the public and the people are welcome to come, and I would like to save the $600.
Councilor Grillman.
Yes, I have to echo Councilor Jordan's thoughts this evening. I think everyone knows that we do our business in public. All our meetings are open to the public. Workshops, budget meetings, and that goes for the school board also. In this tight fiscal year, if we can save $600 and have more people attending in persons, I'd be for that.
Councilor Amaral.
I guess I'd like to give a differing view, because I feel we've invested in very expensive equipment that we would like to be programming more and using public cable as much as possible, given the fact that this past year so many questions have been raised by the public. I think it's a perfect time for us to be offering the public as much possibility to view town actions as we can. So I'd be very much in favor of cable casting any workshops that we can. And if $600 is going to buy covering all of the municipal workshops on the town budget, I think it's a pretty good deal.
Can I clarify one thing, wherever the town manager went? Is the $600, is that already in the budget, or is that going to, would that be an additional $600 we'd have to come up with?
I have a feeling it's additional, because in the past they haven't been covered, except for the...
Unless they haven't used all of their budget yet.
Unless they haven't used it all.
But we do have a town council contingency budget.
Councilor Jordan.
Why I pointed out the way that I did and feel the way I do, I see that when we have a council meetings and the school board meetings, the crew on the camera, which I appreciate them being here, is pretty small, and you see the same faces all the time, and you get into these workshops and these budgets, and I think unless they can find some more help, you're going to wear them down. And I would rather see the people attend the meeting, and maybe if they had a question, they would pose a question, to sit home and just review it on TV and then wait till a later date to pose a question. I think it would be much better to have them present if they're interested, and then they can pose a question at the time.
Councilor Emery.
Well, one of the real advantages of having public cable is that people can be sitting at home watching it. If they have a question, they can get up and come up to town hall and let their opinions be known. I don't know. I just think we should make every effort that we can to let the public know what's happening, and this is a perfect way of doing it.
Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, the reason that I asked the town manager a couple of times about this was because several people in the community had approached me to ask me who they talked to about getting it on cable TV, and so that's why I brought it up. So I think there is support within the community for this, and the $600 figure, perhaps many of the people that were interested in seeing it telecast might even volunteer, because two of the people that asked me do work for Lillian from time to time. So if there's a maximum dollar amount set or something we could do to try to reduce that cost, I still think it would be a worthwhile option. And there are people who can't get to every meeting who might be interested in the good news about having them broadcast 12 times is people might be able to get to see it at their convenience.
We can just say
best forward.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I'll follow up on that last off-the-cuff comment. I do think some of it is going to put people to sleep. This is one of the concerns I have about what we do broadcast over cable. I've sat through two of our budget sessions, and when we are sitting there flipping papers, going, yeah, okay, mm-hmm, people at home, let alone people who attend in person, I guess people in person could get a copy, but if they're at home, they don't necessarily, most often, are not going to have a copy, they're not going to know what page you're on, it's going to be quite foreign to them. I would hate to have someone tune in and go, oh my goodness, what are they doing? I think you lose a lot of the continuity when you're not involved in seeing the process as we all sit there together. With the cable, you know, I know it focuses on the person who's talking, you don't get the full feel of what is really happening. And in this kind of process, I think it's very important to have the continuity to follow the whole discussion rather than tune in, oh my goodness, look what they're doing now. They're